Thank you very much. Somebody thought when we came in here that this would be a debate, and I was trying to think of something. I disagree with you, but I'm struggling. So I want to begin by playing a piece of music that some of you will recognize and others of you will need to be educated.
I'm sick and tired of
That is Mr. Lennon, and this is a country that doesn't exist. This is actually true, that there was a conference, my favorite news story of the past year, there was a conference in Birmingham, England, where 200 people, people with brains, people with education, people who have jobs, people who have responsibility, seriously proposed that the Earth was flat and that Australia doesn't exist. The origin of this is a post on Reddit, back to your social media thing, from someone called Shelley Flord. And there are those who are spherically challenged. They cannot believe that the Earth is round. Quote, it's a hoax made up for us to believe that Britain moved over their criminals to someplace. Sorry for mentioning that history. In reality, all these criminals were loaded off the ships into the waters, drowning before they would ever see land again. It's a cover-up for one of the greatest mass murders in history. Well, what about the pilots? You know, we fly planes. No, no, the pilots are all into it. They fly you to South America. Well, flat Earth theories have been shot down by just about everyone. And I have, all my life, I've never met anyone who's a flat earther until last year. And I've met two since then, and they're serious. I thought they were joking, but they are actually serious. They do exist. Dave March, an NHS worker who spoke at the conference, said, "My research destroys Big Bang cosmology. It supports the idea that gravity doesn't exist and the only true force in nature is electromagnetism." And furthermore, for all of you who are Australians, you don't exist either. You are nothing more than computer-generated personas. And there are people who believe that. That's an extreme example, but I think Australia does exist. In a post-truth world, post-truth, 2016, the Oxford English Dictionary's favorite word or most popular new word, post-truth. Do you know why Donald Trump got elected? Well, according to some journalists in the New York Times and elsewhere, it's because of 16-year-old boys in Macedonia who were paid by the Russians to target dumb Americans. That's basically the idea. Now, you need to take very seriously the fact, in fact, I was speaking to someone in Australia who works with the Australian military, and they are looking at how they can deal with what is cyber warfare, because it is warfare. You know, in the United Kingdom, we still think propaganda is dropping leaflets from planes onto German towns. The Russians and the Chinese are way ahead of the game in this one. And the West is really playing catch up with this. The irony is, of course, that people were complaining, a lot of the journalists and so on were complaining about this post-truth age and we need to claim the truth back. But for years, I've been debating people who say there is no such thing as absolute truth. And now these very same people are complaining. We live in a post-truth world. I say, well, you made it. You created it. That's why one of my favorite writers is a Marxist, runs a website called Spiked, and I loved Spiked stuff usually. I disagree with a lot of it, but it's very well written. And this is what Brendan O'Neill says about the whole situation with post-truth and the panicking on both sides about fake news. He says, "It speaks to the declining moral and cultural authority of our own political and media class. It is the Western world's own abandonment of objectivity and loss of legitimacy in the eyes of its populace that has nurtured something of a free-for-all on the facts and news front." I love newspapers. I subscribed to newspapers until a few years ago. I phoned up a couple of the newspapers I subscribed to and said, I'm not going to subscribe to you anymore because I'm fed up of opinion columns. I don't want to have any more columnists telling me about their children, their cats, their dogs, what they had to eat, and so on. I would quite like news, and I'd like news that you sent journalists to investigate and think about and write about. But newspapers have been shedding journalists and employing opinion columnists. But I've got my own opinions. And I want news. And now they're complaining when the news side of things is disappearing. So virtually every newspaper in the United Kingdom takes one side politically. It's interesting that the only print media that are growing are the quality magazines, which often take different sides. I saw this in Sydney, by the way, with the Sydney Morning Herald. I thought, you know, that I get the Herald a lot because I need to know who my enemy are. No. but I thought I was going to, you know, as a reader of a left-wing commie rag, I was going to attack the fascist in the Australian. But people, there's perceptions. You know how someone is going to report a story now on the basis of their political opinion. And that is that's a really, I think that's a dreadful place for us to be as a society. We've reached the state predicted by the Manic Street Preachers. And of course, you all know who they are. Let's just put up that slide from their album. Just a great title for an album, probably my favorite title. This is my truth, tell me yours. Well, everyone's got their own truth. But when you think about it, that's complete nonsense. What's my truth? Oh, well, racism is wrong. But no, what if my truth is I want to be a racist? Plenty racists. This is my truth. Tell me yours. This is how I see things. Well, it doesn't matter. I mean, in religious terms, people say, well, this is my Jesus. So I don't care two hoots about your Jesus any more than I care about your teddy bear. you know, your teddy bear is probably more real than your version of Jesus. This is my truth. Tell me yours. But that's the world that we've created. A generation that's been told there is no such thing as absolute truth is now being confronted with the consequences of that insane philosophy, and it's now moaning about being post-truth. It's no surprise that people struggle to recognize the difference between real news and fake news. It seems as though there are far too many who are willing to ascribe the term fake news simply to news they don't like or that contradicts their political opinions or worldviews. Donald Trump does something good. I'm reflecting my political bias when I say I don't really want to believe that. But if I'm a journalist, I have to recognize he can do something good. He can do things that are good. And people who I think are good and I agree with, and that's their opinions, they can also do and say things that are bad. But we've tribalized much more than I think most people had anticipated we would. Let's go on to the next one. Here's truth. People complain about post-truth. Put this as a headline. New statistics reveal men have given birth to 54 babies in Australia. No, they haven't. But you're considered to be out of date, out of touch, and wrong if you say that. I'm not making a point here about people who have gender identity dysphoria or the fact that there are people who are transgender. That is not the issue. Men do not give birth. Not unless you change the whole language. And that's one of the reasons that truth is really struggling, because we're changing the meaning of words. You don't know. Am I allowed to say that now? We went to see A Hard Day's Night with the Beatles. You couldn't make that film now. You couldn't show it. For a start, it's racist. It's also misogynist. And it's got a bunch of teenage girls in school uniforms chasing after men. It's not acceptable. It seems one of the problems that we have is not just lies, but perspective. And I want to show you a very old advert, famous advert from The Guardian, which used to be a good newspaper.
An event seen from one point of view gives one impression. Seen from another point of view, it gives quite a different impression. But it's only when you get the whole picture you can fully understand what's going on.
That's a very clever advert. I mean, I remember it from many, many years ago. And the principles in that advert, actually, I'm a historian, and it reminded me of that. That we need to be incredibly careful that we present facts and truths that are uncomfortable for us. So I have to accept that, you know, I look at the case like Cardinal Pell. I am in no position to make any judgment on that because I don't know enough. Except I know this. I know people do get abused, and I know that people do lie about abusers. What disturbs me about the Pell case is the way that people take up a stance according to their preconceived philosophies or beliefs. How do we know what's true? And that, for me, is enormously significant. Perspective is important. Newspaper photos, let me tell you something about them. Let's put up this one. Now, I hesitate to do this because I hate that photo, right? But I want to tell you the story of it. That photo, for some reason, I was preaching at Scots Presbyterian, someone put it up. My sermon was about joy. And of course, can you imagine? This is the Scottish Presbyterian version of joy. You know, and the comments I had to make from a bunch of miserable Australians, honestly. Now, do you know what happens with photos? This particular photo, the journalist came to me and he said, you know, they've got the cameras that take 100 photos. And he said, David, I need to tell you something. He said, editors tell us what kind of photo they want. You can tell what a newspaper's political opinions are by its photos. So if you want Scott Morrison, if you want to support him, you show him looking jovial and light and so on. And if you don't, you show him looking stern and miserable or ridiculous. You just take the photo. The photo is incredible. And a journalist came from the Times to take some photographs with me, and I said, why do you want me out in the graveyard? And why do you want me to put my coat on? And why do you want me to lean on a gravestone? And he said, because my editors told me to get a picture of a miserable-looking Scottish Presbyterian minister in a graveyard in a grey day looking terrible. You know, and that photograph, I was one of hundreds, 100 that were taken for a major newspaper in Scotland, and that's the one they used. Because they were writing against what I was saying. Another story about that, by the way, is another journalist came to do a story I was doing, and we did all the photos, we got on well, and so on. And then I was just mucking around, and I'll never do this again. And I pretended to do a kind of Ian Paisley, like that. And he took that photograph for a laugh. And that was centre page of the newspaper the next day. You know, and I phoned up the editor and said, what do you do that for? He said, I'm really sorry. He said, it was my staff. I said, no, but you carry the can for it. I said, that was outrageous. It was so ridiculous that people knew it was a caricature. But that's what happens. Here's another thing, another way that perspective. Do you know how, this is the anti-abortion march. Now, I'm not making a point about abortion either for or against. If this had been a pro-abortion march, I'd say the same thing. ABC News actually had a headline which said, over 100 people attend abortion rally. Technically true. There were over 100 people. Over 1,000 Jews were killed in the Holocaust. Technically true. But not exactly giving the full picture, is it? So if you have a headline, over 100 people, and I actually saw that, and I happened to be there. I was in the parliament, but not for that, for something else. And I walked past after this was all over, and there were still several hundred people there. And I saw that headline, and I thought, how could you put that? Because you've got a political point to make. Let's move on to this one before I finish. This is how fake news works. I wrote one. It was an April Fool's joke. You know, cynicism and sarcasm. People don't get it now. People don't get irony. It's not just Americans don't get irony. Nobody gets irony. So I wrote this letter about this wonderful news that Nicola Sturgeon was calling for a national day of prayer, and she'd appointed me as her spokesperson and basically Pope for Scotland. And secularists started writing on their website saying how dreadful this was and how dare Sturgeon do this. And some Christians started writing and saying, isn't it wonderful? Isn't it great? You've been, what a wonderful opportunity. And I'm going, I give up. it was sarcasm. And we live in a world which is just so strange. I mean, just think about it this way. We have a reality TV star who's leader of the free world. An Islington Marxist is leader of the Labour Party in the UK. An Italian comedian, leader in Italy. And a Pentecostal becomes Prime Minister of Australia. You think, it's not going to get any stranger. It's going to get way stranger than this. There's hope for you all. Or hope for none of us. Which is why I would argue we need a return to rational thinking. Our minds need to be renewed. We need a rational, coherent worldview, and we need to have trustworthy and thoughtful analysis. So I mentioned Brendan O'Neill, who's a Marxist. I really like his stuff. There's some right-wing people who, they're thoughtful people. I really like their stuff. Do you know my favorite writers at the moment? Tend to be gay, atheist writers like Doug Murray and Matthew Paris. People with whom I profoundly disagree. But I find their perspective is really, really fascinating. And they're honest. They'll say things. The best, for example, Matthew Paris is a gay activist. He's atheist. And he is the person who wrote that what Africa needs is not more UN missions, but more Christian missions. He put it broader than that, but I don't have the time to go into it. So we'll come back to the question that was asked about what is truth. And this is an answer I want to give. I do think there is such a thing as truth. I don't think we should give up on truth. Know the truth and the truth will set you free. I do think that truth brings freedom. I think that truth is best personified in a person. Now, I understand, for those of you who are not Christians, you're going to say, whoa, two religious people in one night. Well, what did you expect? But you can cope. You're mature. You can manage. I'm saying, where does truth come from? You're either saying there's no truth. I'm saying just allow for the moment the possibility that God did send his son, and he said, and that son did say, I am the truth. For me, that is fundamentally important. The people heard him gladly because he spoke as one who had authority. Do you know, I get so fed up with religious leaders. Well, on the one hand this, and on the one hand that, and then Mesopotamia this, and blah, 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 that. And you just think, yeah, tell me some truth. Not narrow, bigoted, prejudiced, emotive, but just truth. And then maybe the last thing I'll say is this. Anthony Flew world's most famous atheist for a while. He did most famous arguments, I think, and best arguments against the idea of God. Towards the end of his days, he wrote a book saying there is a God. He didn't become a Christian, as far as I know. But in the beginning of that book, he gave his Socratic method, which was simply this. Follow the evidence wherever it leads. Follow the evidence wherever it leads. We live in a society in which people have said, this is where it's going to lead. Now give me confirmation. Confirmation bias is seen through all of us. And sadly, social media is the worst for that because they have algorithms. Apparently, Facebook have decided that I'm interested in a Brazilian wife, and honestly, I did not click on any site, but that's, you know. But they know I want to fly to Australia, and they've still got me wanting to fly to Barcelona, and that I'm interested in houses on the North Shore, sorry. And they just keep going. But they do that politically as well with other things, so I try to really confuse them. Follow the evidence wherever it leads. And I come back to about Jesus. There's a man called Dick Lucas said this. God does not so give us much to give us a watertight argument, but a watertight person against whom in the end there can be no argument. See, I believe all truth is God's truth. And so if you're not a Christian, I believe that you can tell me truth. I also believe and know that Christians lie. So I'm not saying just because someone's a Christian, they tell the truth. But I'm saying lies come from the devil. Truth comes from Christ. And whoever we are, we should be seeking truth. We need the truth, if you like, for the truth. Thank you very much.